Okay, so the data you said was up till 2020, so it did not include the... Oh, no, because they had to die, so...
Yeah, they had to die.
So whoever competed in Rio and died till 2020 would be included, but not other medalists on...
Okay.
All right. Hello, Anna. Nice to meet you.
Hi.
Welcome to Evidence Strong. If you could briefly introduce yourself.
Sure. Anna Kovbasiuk, researcher, data scientist, and neuropsychologist. I do my PhD in Warsaw at Kozminski University. I'm not an expert in sports, but I will try my best to share all the insights, and I will be very glad for the feedback from your community.
Thank you so, so much for saying yes to this interview. And we will be discussing a study titled A Taste of Ambrosia. Ambrosia, do Olympic medalists live longer than Olympic losers? Love the title.
Yeah, I know. My supervisor is very good with titles, you know.
It's a great title. So the study is about different Olympic sports. I think you had maybe 20 sports.
Yeah, 20 top numerous sports.
Awesome. Wow, we are the most interested in Olympic weightlifting. So I hope you can tell us maybe what the aim of the study was.
Yes, absolutely. So we've investigated the longevity of Olympic Games participants, and we've checked the interaction between different types of sports and medal won. So that's the study. If you have any other question related to, I don't know, the study design, let me know.
I want to know. So how did you find the data on the medalists and non-medalists?
Yeah, so basically we've turned to Wikipedia and Wikidata. Those are open source encyclopedias. Comparing to different specialized data basis, there are some questions about reliability of open source data, but from the other side, it was a very numerous resource, and studies confirm that the source is reliable, so that's where we turned to. Our sample included around 17,000 elite athletes, and those were top 20 in terms of numbers, Olympic sports. We've conducted our study 4 years ago, so 2020. The majority of the sample were males, unfortunately, so we should take this into account when interpreting the results. And there were only, I think, 7% of females in this database.
Okay, so the data you said was up till 2020, so it did not include because they had to die, so...
Yeah, they had to die.
So whoever competed in Rio and died till 2020 would be included, but not other medalists on... Okay, so I think we're clear on the overall aim of the study. Okay, so maybe let's go into weightlifters. So how many weightlifters did you have? Males, females, and so on?
Okay, so as I've mentioned, there were 17,000 people in the database, and weightlifting, it was around 400, so 2% of the sample. There were, unfortunately, only 3 females. There are not a lot of results on Wikipedia. There was about Valerie Pedro, Judith, Chakun, Saraya Jimenez. That's it.
It makes sense. The women Olympic weightlifters started competing in Sydney in 2000. So it is 24 years ago. So 20 when you were running the study. So I think it's a good news that you know, most of the women are still alive, doing well. So 397 males and 3 females. That sample size.
395 people in weightlifting and 3 females.
All right, got it. Awesome. I think we can go straight to the results. So how long did weightlifters live for, and were there any differences between females, males, and medalists and non-medalists?
Sure. So weightlifters specifically, the average was 68 years with median 71. So a little bit skewed result. Standard deviation, which shows like the dispersion of the results, is 16 years. Minimum, it was 22 actually. It was Waldemar Malak, who is a Polish weightlifter, so 22 years, and maximum 99 years, Martin Olofsson. So this is about weightlifters. Regarding differences in life duration between medalists versus non-medalists, because this was our main question. Yes, we've seen that Olympic medalists lived shorter than non-medalists, and specifically in weightlifting. The difference was more more or less a year, but it was significant. We've seen that Olympic medalists had shorter life duration generally, so 72 years compared to non-medalists. It was around a year, so 71 and 72 and a half, something like this. And however, we did not see that the color of medal, there were no significant differences in the longevity. So to sum up, Olympic medalists lived shorter than non-medalists, but the color of medal was not.
Okay, it doesn't matter which medal the athlete receives, but if they do receive medal, they are likely to live shorter.
Shorter, yes, that's true. And athletes in specific disciplines, because we've compared also the average in the athlete group to the averages in different disciplines. And we've seen that weightlifting, but also boxing, wrestling, ice hockey, cycling, football, swimming, in those disciplines, people were living shorter comparing to the mean in the group of athletes.
But if on comparison, just mentioned this, the disciplines where the athletes were living longer or the longest.
The longest, yes. Okay, so we've seen that longest were living from more like hill disciplines comparing to power. So equestrian, sailing, those disciplines.
All right, so fresh air and travel.
Kinda, yeah. It seems like it. We will probably discuss also like why.
Yes, please.
So we can make some. I think from the perspective of sports, there were longer lifespans. It was athletics, rowing, fencing, shooting, cross country skiing, sailing, and equestrian. That's I think it. So speaking about why. Okay, first of all, I want to mention something important because there are different factors that are contributing to longevity and they interact in very complex ways. So establishing, you know, cause and effect relationship is kind of challenging in the longevity studies. We can try to deduce some factors. So what we've done is we've compared disciplines that are engaging power, so isometric or static training, and we've seen that power disciplines were linked to the shorter lifespan and those that are relying for skills for success to longer. So skill sports, they rely more on lower than in other disciplines, static and dynamic components and training of kind of technical ability. So this was our like very tentative hypothesis that maybe just the components that you are training. But of course, like physical demands, this is one thing, but additionally, cardiovascular health might be important because both power and skill, of course, offer some benefits, but the nature of maybe training of power sports can be a little bit different. So there are other studies that revealed a little bit poorer cardiovascular health. The studies are contradictory on this topic, but this can be a reason, very tentatively speaking. Additionally, of course, some socioeconomic factors can play a role because maybe there are some additional challenges that athletes face, like, I don't know, limited access to the healthcare, more like systemic problems, financial instability, or problems to find post-career opportunities for development. We've seen also that, and I think you've had a very interesting thought on it, that doping influence, so the use of performance-enhancing drugs in power sports, this can be a concerning issue because they can provide some short-term benefits, right? You can correct me if I'm wrong, because those are just some initial thoughts, but they can be related to some long-term health complications. So basically, maybe anti-doping effects can be helpful, right? And should be raised in the sporting community. So to sum it up, one of the reasons might be physical demands of the sport, but also from the other side, some socioeconomic and doping and those factors. But establishing causality is tough, you know. I want to very much emphasize this.
That's okay. We are just trying to here to play the guess game. I understand that this is not what the study was about, but I cannot not ask. So
yeah.
Did you have a look at the data and try to find whether some of the athletes were sanctioned? So whether they had some kind of proven doping history?
So that's a very, very interesting idea, we unfortunately did not, but I've checked that this information is available on Wikipedia and there are lists of the sanctioned athletes. I think it's a very, very interesting idea to check it. Additionally, we were thinking about a ranking of like popularity of disciplines to take this into account, because it can be indirectly showing that, you know, factors that are linked to popularity might be causing, might be related to the differences in longevity. So short answer is no, we did not.
Awesome. That would be something maybe to look into.
Absolutely.
Oh yeah, one more question. Did you have a look at the different geographical regions and the long?
So yeah, about geographical regions, yes, there were, we included in the study different geographical regions. We did not take this into account as a factor to check the longevity. So we basically concentrated just on the disciplines and on the medals.
All right. Okay. Last question. Very hard to answer, I know. So my apologies again. Would you have any ideas how to prevent? Because like 68, it's not that good, to be honest. We would like our athletes, especially the medalists, to live longer and pass on the experience and motivation and, you know, be contributing to society a little bit longer than 68. So are there any things we could do to extend the life of our athletes, especially the ones that are Olympic, even at the moment? At least even competing in the Olympics in weightlifting is a huge achievement. Then the numbers are so slim in terms of how many athletes can qualify that it's a huge achievement. So if we could have them for longer, that would be awesome.
Absolutely. And we are all here for this. So basically what, because of course we've done some literature review and there are studies, there are mixed results on the cardiovascular health. And the differences, some studies show that there are differences, some show that there are no to the general population. So especially among the athletes with obesity. So cardiovascular health might be the direction for like including the exercises that also have some elements of cardiovascular activities like swimming, cycling. Yeah, they can promote the endurance, improve the overall health. So what we've seen that longer lifespans were in, as I mentioned, skill sports. So sports that is the combination of physical abilities plus technical fitness. So including some sports that are linked to more training of the skills, just as a change to make it a more, I don't know, varied types of exercises can be helpful too. Also, I think it's essential to address socioeconomic factors because we can have the influence on them, maybe even easier than on the like health and exercise. So trying to make sure that athletes have some easier post-career transitions or basically this can be the direction, providing support for holistic well-being of athletes. Additionally, what else? Maybe also prioritizing their well-being through the careers by, for instance, implementing evidence-based changes in the system. So I think that can be crucial in the support of them, in the support of living long and healthy lives.
So what I'm hearing is one is the holistic support of an athlete while they are competing at the highest level. And the second is paying attention what happens with the athletes after they retired from professional sport or from competing at the Olympic level. And maybe in investigating how to best transition them in terms of socioeconomic status and career and family and other social networks to provide good base for healthy retirement from sports.
Yeah, absolutely. I think those factors can be crucial for the long, healthy life of athletes. What about you? What are your thoughts? What can be done additionally? Maybe some directions for future studies?
The things we already discussed are plenty. If we could figure out how to take good care of athletes while they are competing, is we know that there is research showing that weightlifting, Olympic weightlifting in particular, is a super safe and really good sport for kids, recreational athletes, masters athletes, everyone apart from Olympic athletes. So the highest level is detrimental to health. they get injured, they have other issues. Of course, then historically, doping was an issue, a huge issue in Olympic weightlifting. Maybe not always in terms of rules breaking, but always in terms of health consequences. So
yeah,
there's a lot of things to unpack and straighten in this aspect. So I would be interested to see more studies focused on health and well-being of athletes, especially at the highest level, because I think in recreational athletes of all ages, weightlifting seems to be safe and have more benefits than risks by far.
Yeah.
It's a very safe sport, but at the highest level, it still seems to be, we don't have a lot of studies, but it seems to be a problematic sport in terms of health, like many professional or sports at the highest level. So
yeah,
if we could mitigate these risks a little bit, that would be awesome.
Yeah, absolutely.
All right. Thank you so much for your study. I have two more questions. One, your favorite color?
Ooh, that's a cool question. I think I'm in my like burgundy phase. So as you can
see. All right.
On my nails.
Burgundy it is. And if people want to find you and see your work on the internet, where they should go?
Sure. So I think LinkedIn would be a good place. You can see my name here, probably somewhere. And I think also our papers are on ResearchGate. So ResearchGate is the place where you can find studies. So yeah, ResearchGate by my name and surname or LinkedIn page.
Thank you so much, Anna. It was my pleasure.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me, and good luck with collecting those evidence-based research.
Thank you so much.